I would like to just make sure that everybody is familiar with the concept of continuous integration. So if I could get a quick show of hands, who is familiar with continuous integration? So it looks like some people. For those of you who are not familiar with it, it is a software engineering practice that involves frequently pushing your changes up to version control. So some of the older practices might have had developers pushing all their changes up at the end of the day, versus with continuous integration, you're going to be doing that multiple times a day. When these changes are made, then there is going to be some sort of system in place that's going to detect these changes and then go through and automatically build a project and then run through regression testing. So there are obviously some advantages to this, and that's why it's been adopted as a practice. One of the main ones is that it helps avoid these challenging merge conflicts. So as you can imagine, if developers are only pushing up their changes, say, once a day at the end of the day, then it's much more likely that two developers have gone through and tried to make changes to the same file, versus if you're continuously pushing those changes up, then you're not going to run into this, you know, difficult of conflicts to untangle. Similarly, with isolating what might have caused a problem with a build, if developers are going through and pushing those changes up frequently, then the changes are going to be smaller relative than to changes when they're pushing up just one big change at the end of the day, which is going to lead to less code that you have to comb through to try to figure out what caused the problem. And ultimately, this leads to people spending less time staring at debuggers, which I am personally all for. So, like I said, there's a system that is in place to do these things, to automatically go through and run these builds and run through regression testing. And so there have been a number of continuous integration servers that have been introduced to meet this need, and Jenkins is one of these. It's probably one of the more popular ones, if not one of the most popular ones. It's an open source continuous integration server written in Java. Since it is open source, there are tons of contributors to the project, which has led to tons and tons of plugins. I don't know the exact number, but the last time that I've looked, there are upwards of 1,000 plugins for Jenkins. So basically, if you can think of a tool that you might have some sort of use for with Jenkins, there's probably some sort of plugin that will meet your need. Basically, the way that this works is you set Jenkins up to monitor a code repository for you. And so it has built-in support for Git and Subversion. I'm sure if there's any other sort of version control system, there's probably a plugin that gives you support for that as well. The way that I've got it configured is I configure it to watch GitHub, and so when GitHub projects are changed, we go through and automatically save of that project. Now, the way that Jenkins actually goes through and does that build is something that you can configure yourself, and there are several ways that you can actually do that. So you can have Jenkins configured to execute shell commands. You can have Jenkins use build tools such as Ant or Maven or Gradle. Specifically, I use a lot with Maven, just because it's sort of simplified what I'm looking at. And you can also specify ways to run tests. I've been using JUnit to run tests on my projects. Then based on the results of these builds, you can have Jenkins do several things. Post-build, it can send email notifications to developers based on the results of the build. You can also have it, like I said, I use JUnit with it. JUnit can generate test report XML files, and you can have Jenkins publish those test report XMLs, which ultimately leads to you having this nice graph on the Jenkins GUI that shows you the performance of your tests over time. In just a few minutes, I'm going to go ahead and do a demonstration of Jenkins so that you can actually see some of this in action. But before I jump into that, I just want to talk briefly about my work with Jenkins. So the motivation for my work is that regression testing is an expensive, time-consuming process. I know that at least one paper that I looked at talked about a test suite that actually took 7 weeks to run through. Admittedly, that paper was published in 2001, so computing power has probably come a little ways since then. Hopefully they're not taking 7 weeks anymore, but the principle is still the same. Regression testing is an expensive process and it takes up valuable computing resources. And this is especially difficult in a continuous integration environment when you're constantly making changes and constantly rebuilding the project and running through those regression tests. So ultimately, the goal of my research is to sort of minimize that cost and do what we can to select and prioritize tests that are going to be more important. There are different ways that you can actually define what makes a test important, but what I'm looking at is trying to select and prioritize tests that are going to reveal failures faster. So they're going to find failing tests faster. So I've been working on developing a plugin for Jenkins that will sort of automate the test case selection prioritization process using regression test selection and test case prioritization algorithms. Regression test selection and test case prioritization are basically exactly what they sound like. Regression test selection is the process of selecting which regression tests to run. So it tries to find the important tests, and it will select those ones, and those are the only tests that it will run. Test case prioritization, on the other hand, it will run all of the tests that are relevant to a changed file, but it tries to assign priority values to those tests so that it will run the more important tests earlier. The way that this works, at least with my plugin, is when a build is scheduled on Jenkins, my plugin will go back and look through the build history of the past builds for this job, and it will look at the test results from those builds. It then uses those test results along with a couple of user-defined parameters to try to prioritize and select the important tests. The two main parameters that it uses are a failure window and an execution window. So basically, tests that have failed within the failure window are going to be selected or prioritized, and tests that have not been executed within the execution window are going to be selected or prioritized. So recently failing tests or tests that have not been executed. So that's sort of where I'm at right now. I have got this mostly implemented the way that I want to. I have not yet run through testing on some real world projects. That's sort of the next step for what I'm going to be doing with my research, is trying to apply this to some real world projects and seeing how it actually performs, and then try to modify things, modify parameters and the algorithms, and see what gets us the optimal results in terms of prioritization and selection. So the next thing that I'd like to do is try to give a quick demo of Jenkins and possibly the plugin as well. So as you can see, I use the shell a little just myself. So when you download Jenkins, it's usually going to be a .war file, and you can run it just by doing java-jar jenkins.war, and that's going to get that started. I'm going to go ahead and copy this GitHub URL and make sure that Jenkins is running. If anybody's curious why it says Elizabeth's MacBook Pro, I had to borrow my sister's. So, by default, Jenkins runs on localhost port 80. And so when you navigate to that, it's going to have you authenticate. The first time that you run it, it actually has some configuration that you can do. It'll ask you if you want to install the recommended plugins. I do usually recommend installing the recommended plugins. If you do not install the recommended plugins, then you won't have access to things like GitHub webhooks, which I ran into when I was trying to walk somebody through how to use this the other day. So once you log in, this is sort of the main Jenkins dashboard. Here in the center of the page, you have the different projects that you've configured. TCP test is the one that I've most recently been using to test my test case prioritizer. And TCP, in this case, does stand for test case prioritizer and not transmission control protocol. And somebody asked me if that was the TCP internet protocol earlier. When you get to this page, you've got these menu items over here on the left-hand side. When you want to create a job, you just click New Item. And it will actually come up with several different types of jobs that you can configure for Jenkins. The most common ones are probably going to be the Freestyle Project pipeline. Freestyle Project is primarily what I've been using. It's sort of the easiest thing to configure. Pipeline is actually a little newer, a little bit more cutting edge. If anybody is interested in Jenkins and wants to explore further, I do recommend taking a look at Pipeline. But for right now, I'm just going to talk about Freestyle. So I'm going to select Freestyle, and I'm just going to give a name to my project and click OK. And when I do that, it's going to actually load up the configuration for this job. Up top, obviously, you've got the project name, description, and then down below that, you have a lot of parameters that you can define for the project. Some of them are not extremely obvious what they would do. So if you're not sure, most of them do have this little blue question mark help icon. And if you click on that, it'll expand and give you probably more information than you could possibly ever want about that particular parameter. Normally, I would be using the GitHub project option up there. That's how you configure it to receive webhooks from GitHub and automatically build. But in order for that to work, you have to make your local host available publicly on the internet, and that takes a few minutes for me to set up, so I'm going to skip that for right now. And just go down to Source Code Manager and choose Git. And this is where I'm going to paste in that GitHub URL that I copied. It has a place where you can provide credentials for your GitHub as well. This is a public repository, so I don't actually have to provide those credentials. If I was going to do the GitHub webhooks, you do have to provide the credentials. So there's actually a way that you can configure that in the global settings of Jenkins rather than the project settings so that it will always have access to your repositories. You can specify different things about what it does when it looks at this repository as well. Here you can see that it's looking specifically at the master branch. If I wanted to change that, I could specify a different branch, or I could even have it look at multiple branches. Down below that, we've got build triggers, which are exactly what they sound like. Those are events that will trigger builds. So you can have builds run periodically. The one that I usually use, the one you would use to hook it with GitHub, is the GitHub hook trigger. Like I said, you have to make localhost publicly accessible from the internet to be able to use that, though. Build environment, I actually have not worked with that too much, but there are some options there as well. The important one down here is build, and this is where you actually can configure how Jenkins will go through and build your job. So like I said, you can configure it to execute shell commands, you can use Ant, Gradle, Maven. I'm going to be using Maven just because the GitHub project that I just specified happens to be a Maven project. As you can see, it also has regression test selector and test case prioritizer listed up here. That's because this Jenkins instance happens to have my plugin installed on it, and we'll get back to that in a minute. For right now, we're going to invoke the top level Maven targets, and I'm going to do the test target. And then under post build actions, like I said, you can have it send email notifications to developers based on the results of builds. And you can also have it publish test reports. And since mine happens to run JUnit tests, we're going to do that as well. And Maven always puts the surefire reports directory. So once you've configured your job, this is what it'll take you to. It looks a lot like the dashboard, only has some different options specific to the job that you're looking at. So over on the left, where you had the same options that you had before, you now have a build now option, which is how we're actually going to manually trigger a build. And when you click on that, it'll take a second to see it pop up over here under build history. And it'll take a second here. Once it's complete, that little dot up top stops flashing. There are a few different results that you can see from that little dot. It gives you a blue dot if the build was completely successful. It gives you a yellow dot if the build was unstable. And it gives you a red dot if the build fails. As you can see, it's unstable. The GitHub project that I have is configured specifically to have failing tests for the purpose of testing my plugin. The center of the screen is where it gives you some information about the build. Where you see no changes up there, it would actually list the changes that have been made on GitHub since the last build. Down below that, you can see the test results, so you can see that there was one test failure. If you go to console output, you'll get detailed output that you would normally see, say, in a shell. Up top, mostly you have Jenkins checking out the files from Git. So below that, you can see it actually calls the MVN test command, so that's it. Calling Maven and having Maven go through and run the test target. This output below that is probably familiar for anybody who is familiar with Maven. So it runs through, builds the project, and then down here we've got our unit tests and we've got the output. So I'm going to go back to the project real quick, and I'm actually going to run one more build just so that I can show you the point of publishing those test results. After we run a second build, we get this nice little graph up here that shows our test result trends. So you can see your test results over time, which is an extremely useful feature. Just to show sort of a little bit about my plugin, I'm going to go back now to this TCP test project that I have already created over here. And for some reason, it's not showing the test result trend, which is interesting. Anyways, I'm going to go ahead and make a change real quick. to one of the files that I have on GitHub. And so now when I go through and build, it's going to try to run my plugin. Otherwise, the job is configured more or less the same as the other one. It is set up to receive those GitHub webhooks, but it's not going to do it right now since we're not publicly accessible from the internet. But down under build, you can see we have an additional build step here where it's got the test case prioritizer and some parameters that I've defined just for testing out the project. There's the test results from that. So where I've gone through and run it now, we can see that we've got these changes, and we can see that we still got a test failure, because it's the same project. Console output, again, you see Jenkins retrieving the files from Git. Down below that, instead of just jumping straight into the Maven test target, you can see that it's running the test case prioritizer. You can see where it has set some of these parameters, and then it actually runs through and does this code. So where it says running dependency analysis code, I've also got it set up to look at a static code analysis tool to try to figure out what files are dependent or related to the changed files. So as you can see, I only changed one of the JUnit tests, and it finds that these are the dependent files, the test itself, and the class that it actually tests. And then it goes through and tries to find which of these might be failing, which of these might not have been executed. And if we scroll down here, we can see that it actually only ran one test because there was only one test that was related to the change. If it ran more, it would actually try to order those based on which ones have been failing and which ones have not been executed recently. But that is just about all I actually have. Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
I have some applications that this might be very nice on, but how do I test an application whose job is to be a web service that people are going to be interacting with? How can I test to see if my change is broken something?
That's a good question. I'm not 100% sure. I know that it can go through and build it. There are different testing frameworks for testing, like, say, web applications. I think Selenium is one for, say, a web page itself that actually goes through and instead of actually having a user interact with it, there's a program that mimics user input. So there might be something like that where you can have a test program go through and provide your program with input. And you would be able to run all of that through Jenkins so long as there is something like that that's runnable.
So often a change I make is to add a feature.
Yeah.
And then what used to work, those buttons no longer exist. I can't play with those anymore. And new buttons now exist.
Yeah, so that's, you could probably create some sort of program that would try to find those buttons and try to interact with them, and then when it's unable to find and interact with those buttons, it would tell you that, hey, it's not working, and it would tell you, depending on how you set up the test, it would tell you what things aren't working, so.
Thanks.
Does your prioritizer take into account relevance or some closeness of the test, the change that was made?
So right now, it does sort of. It looks at the file level. So like I said, I actually utilize a static code analysis tool as well. It's called Scitools Understand. It creates a dependency graph between the different files and different classes. And so my dependency analysis code actually does is it retrieves information from that static code analysis tool to figure out what files are related to the file that was changed. And so it will only run tests that are found to be related to that file. It doesn't include anything or not. Now it only looks at the file level right now. We've talked a little bit about changing the levels of granularity there to see what the effects of that might be, but currently it just looks at the file level. So unstable just means that there are failing test results, but that the build was successful. So it was able to go through, it was able to build the project. I've got Maven configured to ignore test test failures right now. You can actually have Maven fail a build if there are test failures, but it will actually successfully build. It just lets you know that there's something that's not passing.
I have one more question.
Yes.
How would you evaluate how well you did UX?
So that's sort of the next thing. We're going to look at running this with some real world projects. What we want to do is.
But what is the objective function?
Try to optimize. So I'm trying to reveal test failures faster. So I want the failing tests to be at the top of the test queue. Basically, those need to be executed earlier on so that those are found faster. So I want to compare this side by side with just normal testing, where there's no order to it. It just runs in an arbitrary order. So. Anybody else? Thank you very much.
Thank you.